is worth it all, to surrender all to Him. I want to share a gospel reading this morning out of the Gospel of John, the 15th chapter, verses 9 through 17. Now, this is part of what Jesus records that Last Supper, the last night that Jesus with His disciples. And you can imagine when somebody knows it's near the end of the time together that they'll want to say what's most important. And so in this upper room, this is part of what Jesus is telling His disciples, and again, I think He shares it with us as well, but we might know this is one of the deepest things on Jesus' heart that He wants them to know, and us also. So this is John chapter 15. I want to start at verse 9. Again, it's Jesus speaking, and He says, "As the Father has loved Me, so I have loved you. Abide in My love. If you keep My commandments, you will abide in My love, just as I have kept My Father's commandments and abide in His love. I have said these things to you so that My joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is My commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. And you are My friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from My Father. You did not choose Me, but I chose you and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask Him in My name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another." Well, this is our reading from the Word of God. We're actually in the midst of a couple things this morning. One of them, we're coming to a conclusion, a time with our bounty campaign, the annual stewardship campaign. We invite members of the church to consider their giving through the church. And this year, we've really been emphasizing the idea of a bounty, the gifts that God has given to us, which motivates us in realizing out of that blessedness, out of that bounty, how we're able then to give to others and give through the church for the ministry of Christ's church here in the world. We've had now each week different testimonies and videos in the video format. And this morning, I want to start my time with you with hearing from Craig and Jan Windmiller. And they're going to talk about the cross, you'll see, but also share their story, what makes them give, and their connection here. So we're going to watch that video now, the bounty video with Craig and Jan Windmiller.
We joined in October of 1977 when our first son was a baby, and wanted to get established in a church and raise our family in a good Methodist church.
We have many fond memories, but one that really stands out is small groups. 20-odd years ago, Pastor Dale Batchelor, who's no longer here, asked us if we would come to a meeting. Meetings with Dale lasted about 3 months, and then he turned to sleeves and said, "Now you're going to be small group leaders, and pick some people that you would like to have as your group, and start off, and you meet roughly 2 hours, and a couple times a month would be appropriate." Well, the first meeting we had was in our house, and I think we had about six couples, maybe, and at 11:30 that evening, they were still there. We were just having a ball. We said, "Well, this is going to be really fun." We bonded friendships that we would never have, and families. Very, very much fun.
We give and serve because God asks us to give and serve. We feel very blessed that we are able to, and we want to honor His request for us, and love that Asbury is good about mission work, both locally and in beyond, and that the monies that we give are helping to support those ministries.
Everyone has their talent or their passion or whatever. Obviously mine is building and that sort of thing. So I've been involved with the renovations of the church. When we go to pick out a furnace, I'm involved, the roofs, one of the fun things that I was involved with, Doris Miller asked me to do something with Gene Miller's walnut that he had for 50 years. So we went to his basement and looked, and he had a lot of walnut. And I asked her if we could maybe do a cross out of it. So the cross that you see in the sanctuary, I helped design, and one of my craftsmen put it together for us. People need their own passion and do the talent that they like to do.
So part of what we're doing today is, again, coming to a conclusion with that bounty campaign. For those of you that have brought your pledge cards for the coming year, when we receive communion later this morning, we'll have a model church in the center aisle. You can place your cards in the church. You can place your offering on the plates that'll be here on either side, and then come to receive a communion. One of the things I appreciated, though, as we put these videos together, that the timing was such that Reverend Miller, he referred to Reverend Miller, was a previous pastor here in the church. And he had the walnut, of which after he had passed away, you know, Craig helped to construct the cross there. But Reverend Miller was my great-grandmother's youth pastor back in Edmond, Oklahoma, before we came here. I mean, that was his first church out of seminary. And he was the youth. She wasn't a youth at the time. She wasn't her, but she was the pastor, or he was the pastor, the youth pastor there at that church in Edmond. So we've known Reverend Miller all those years back from then. But it's significant in that the cross that has been made, and is the symbol that we live with day in, day out as followers of Jesus. And when Jesus told his disciples in that upper room, "There's no greater love than this, to lay down your life for your friends." They didn't know it at the time, but that's what Jesus was about to do on the cross. And so the cross is a great reminder of how it is that we give our lives for others. Occasionally, sometimes it's by giving up our lives. But there's also the aspect of living our lives for others and for God. And I want to talk about those two ways today and share an example. Some examples with you. Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we do thank you today for the love that you've shown to us in your Son Jesus, and also how that love is reflected in the people of our lives. We pray that as we open our hearts to your presence and your word, that your Spirit would empower us to share that love with others as well. We pray this now in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, as I mentioned, you know, getting ready for this sermon and this series of, through this time is a season of giving, and kind of the idea of giving of our lives. And the two ways to do that, that the scriptures, I think, lifted up for us today, and the one is by giving of our life, laying our life down for others. Again, that's how Jesus ultimately proved the greatest sacrifice. Willing to put others in ahead of himself, to show the very character of God, what love is all about, to put someone else's interests ahead of their own. And so Jesus in that upper room was saying that this is what I want you to do. These are my commandments, that you love one another as I have loved you. And there's no greater love than for someone to lay down their life for a friend. He told him, and you're my friends. I care for you. I mean, obviously that's the ultimate sacrifice, the way that we know that we can trust God, that God loves us, because he did that for us in his Son. And it's also true that, you know, there are times when we see other people who will do that for someone else. And I want to lift up to you an illustration or story of my great-grandfather. So his name was Fred Lee. And share with you part of the story of my great-grandfather and his wife, my great-grandmother, Juanita Angerman was her maiden name. But here's a picture of Fred Lee as a young man. He was a baseball player, and he worked in Oklahoma. He played baseball in Arizona. He and my great-grandmother got married in 1917, August, as a 24-year-old couple. He then was drafted into the service, and this is during World War I. So they went, and here's a picture of their, right before they got married, Juanita. So they, like I say, Juanita, but we all just called her Nina. So Nina and Fred Lee, there's just a few days before their wedding. Anyway, he was then shipped off, or they trained in Kansas, at a fort in Kansas. And while they were there, then she became pregnant. And baby getting close to born, so she went back to Oklahoma to have the baby with the idea that on a leave, my great-grandfather would come see her and see the baby and so on. However, the base was quarantined, because then they were prepared to ship off over into Europe. So shipped off and then went over to, trained in England and then eventually in France. But all those times while he was gone, he wrote letters back to my great-grandmother. And don't get ahead of me there too much. Keep going back, go back. We'll go back to the, back another one there. So there's a picture of my great-grandmother and my grandmother. He was shipped off before my grandmother was born. And so then part of the idea, they sent these letters. Okay, so now let's look at, here's one of the letters. My great-grandmother had them, passed them down to my mother, and then I have, now my son has like a digital copy of them. And so, go ahead and we'll do the next one. There is a letter to Little Miss Mona Lee, Mona Catherine Lee, and Mrs. Fred Lee in Edmond, Oklahoma. And you'll see down in the left-hand corner that's the censored by somebody, because these letters were censored in terms of what kind of content, you know, could be delivered. So the next picture has an example of a letter, and you can see where somebody's gone through and blacked out anything that might be, you know, sensitive in terms of military information. So he served then in part of what happened then, he was shipped off before my grandmother was born. And then these letters, you know, back and forth, you know, we've been able to read them. And my son has been sending out an email of the content of the letters like 100 years ago to the day that Fred Lee wrote this letter. And so since last May, I mean, every now and then we'll get an email from my son saying, this is what Fred Lee wrote today, 100 years ago, to his wife. And so, for example, here's one, August 7, 1918. Dear Juanita and dear baby. This is part of a lengthy letter, but there's part of it just says, if I live and get back home, I'll certainly have lots to tell you. I know I'll be home to you, dear, perhaps before you can realize it. I'm trusting that I shall anyway. I'd certainly like to kiss that sweet baby of ours tonight, and I'm wondering what you could be doing this very night. I think of you so much. I'm sitting in such a position I can't hardly write. I've got a small piece of board I write on. In other words, he was in France and pretty much on the front lines. He was on a machine gun battery. And so in some of the final offenses of the war, he was right in the mix of it. But he wrote, you know, many times and would kind of describe the things that he was seeing. But he would often end his letters with, be brave, and tell his wife to be brave. Love and kisses, your husband, Sergeant Fred D. Lee, 342nd Machine Gun Battalion. Now, as time went on then, the war came to a final offensive. And 100 years ago, last Thursday, on November 1st, there was an artillery round and the shrapnel hit my great-grandfather in the leg. And I always thought he was injured, but learned this past week, my son had done some research, he actually had his leg blown off. And he was then, it wasn't until 5 days later that he even got to the hospital. So if you imagine that would have happened Thursday, even by today, he's still not at a hospital yet. So he was then in the hospital, or in a military hospital there in France, and on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month is when the truce was called and the armistice was announced and the war ended. And so that'll be a week from today at about this time, the 11th hour, the 11th day, 11th month. And next week, I won't be here because I'm going to go down to Oklahoma and with my cousin go out to Fred Lee's grave and put a wreath on his grave on the 11th hour, the 11th day, 11th month. Now, on the 12th day, the next day, the 12th of November, is when this telegram was sent. This was a Western Union telegram. Actually didn't get there till December, but basically said, regret to inform you that your husband, Fred Lee, died on November the 12th. The day after the war ended. So I guess part of what has inspired us over the years is, you know, the whole story of Fred Lee, who gave his life for his family, for his country, and the many sacrifices that many people have made. But that's been a personal one for us. Now, the other side of that is not only laying down your life, but how you can live your life for others. Jesus said, there's no greater love than this, to be willing to lay down your life for others. But when Paul wrote to those Romans, the Christians in Rome, he said, I appeal to you therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. And what is good and acceptable and perfect is to give of yourself for others, to live your life for others, to share your life with others, and make your life a living sacrifice in with what God has given to you. So my great-grandmother, as a single mom during the Depression and all those years, raised my grandmother. She went on to be a teacher, a principal in Oklahoma. And a couple years, go ahead, we'll go a couple slides more. There is her family in 1991 with my great-grandmother in the middle and my grandmother, her three kids and this grandkids and the great-grandkids and the great-great-grandkids back then. But I guess where Nina's been an ongoing inspiration is that she truly gave up her life. She lived her life for her family and for her church and for her community. I mentioned as a great-grandson, she brought toys back for us. She painted that silver or the china set. You can see some of those on the table outside there. But after she passed away, they found in her belongings by her Bible, by her bed, a card that had a prayer on it. And that's the prayer that's on your bulletin cover. That, you know, we don't know for sure if she read it every day or how she used it, but I have it as a bookmark in my devotional book. And it just reminds me of her to think, you know, a morning prayer to start the day, oh God, for another day, for another moment, or for another morning, for another hour, for another minute, for another chance to live and serve thee, I am truly grateful. And isn't that a way to live our lives for others? It has been an inspiration for me all this time. She lived to be 100 years old. And I think she did because she cared for so many other people. That's maybe what kept her going. And she is now a part of my life. Now, again, it's something to think about, you know, 100 years ago, the things that were happening to this day. But remember those kids I had stand up here and take a look at them? Imagine 100 years from now what this world is going to be. Many of us probably won't see that day, but some of those kids, there's a good chance that they might, or at least they might know somebody, their kids or their grandkids or their grandkids who will. And friends, I believe what we do now will have a bearing on the kids, the children, the families 100 years from now. Now, we're ready for Jesus to come at any time that we face our own death, and that'll be, in a sense, the second coming. But also, we've got to be ready if we're here 100 years from now, what will this world be like? So when you go out this week to vote, and you need to vote, when you go out this week to share your lives for your family members, with the neighbors, with the people through the church, what we're doing in this church, through this congregation, through the annual pledges that we're going to make, through the giving that we're doing, we're investing in life, in those people's lives, 100 years from now. And we do it a day at a time. Some of us may be called to lay down our lives, but it's more likely we'll be invited to live our lives for others. And when we do that and follow Jesus' example, we'll be continuing his work on this world for the sake of this world and these kids that we saw in front of us. So in a moment, we're